This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book The Elves of Mount Fern by Katherine Creighton. Lesson number 1, The Elves of Mount Fern. The elves are the dearest and most mischievous little people in all the wide world. They live in Elfland, and Elfland can be found in every corner of the globe. They take up their abode on wooded hillsides, beside murmuring streams, or in deep leafy forests. In the dead of night, when all the world is still, they steal forth from their dwellings and start on their merry midnight rounds. They dance in the moonlight on soft dewy lawns under wide-spreading trees. They visit their neighbors and friends among elves, and their neighbors and friends among men. The elves can see and not be seen, they can hear and not be heard, and are so light and nimble in their movements that they can float through the air like a leaf in the wind. Once upon a time there was a company of elves that lived in a stone wall. They had left their home in the forest glade for a season in the giant world, as they called our world, because it seemed so big to them. While they were wandering about in search of a place to settle, they came upon a hole in a stone wall that exactly suited them, it was so snug and comfortable. The elves were very much delighted, and at once decided to make their home there. The wall belonged to Dr. Templeton. He liked privacy, and so he had this high stone wall built all around his garden and grounds. But Dr. Templeton's gardener was very lazy and careless, and when some stones fell out of the wall, he simply rolled them over the bank. That was easier, he thought, than mending the wall, and besides, the wall was so very thick that a few stones more or less did not matter in the least. The elves thought it was very fortunate for them that the gardener was so lazy and careless, and promised themselves a gay good time with a season in the giant world. The members of this company of elves were Captain Featherweight, the head of the company; Rainbow, master of ceremonies; Rhymo, the poet elf; Tono, the music elf; Lightning, the messenger elf; Iris Wing, the flower elf; Touchstone, the jester; Owly, the wise one; Slumber, the dream elf. After the elves had made a tour of all the grounds around Templeton Hall, their captain called them together to decide upon a name for their new home. "Let us call our new home Scale Cliff," said Tono, the music elf. "A very pretty idea," said Rainbow, "but don't you think Rocklight would be prettier still?" "Rocklight won't do at all," said Slumber, the dream elf, "because it suggests wakefulness, so I propose that we call it Slumber Nest instead." "Can't you think of anything but dreams and slumber?" asked Iris Wing, the flower elf. "I wouldn't live in a place with a name like Slumber Nest, and so I move that we call our new home Rose Bower." "Pooh pooh," said Owly, the wise one. "Rose Bower suggests a garden, and a garden isn't a house, so I think you'll all agree with me that Stone Wall Gap is much more appropriate." "We don't agree, Owly," said several of the elves at once. But here Captain Featherweight called the meeting to order, and ended all dispute by declaring that the name of the new home should be Mount Fern, because there was a fern growing just below, at the foot of the wall. As a rule, the elves lived in peace and harmony, and they adored their captain. His word was law, and when any disputes arose he always acted as judge. After the name of the new home had been decided upon, Captain Featherweight gave each elf his work to do in its arrangement and furnishing, and in a very short time it was all in perfect order and ready to live in. The captain was very much pleased, and complimented his elves on their ability to do their work well and quickly. "And since our house is now all in perfect order," said the captain, "let us have some music to celebrate the event. Tono, will you please sing something for us?"
"With pleasure," answered Tono. "What would you like?"
"I leave the selection entirely to you," said the captain. Then Tono, who was leader of the elfin choir, played and sang. "Twinkle, twinkle, firefly bright, through the dark and cloudy night, floating gaily in the air, here and there and everywhere, how your cheerful little gleam
joyful makes the darkness seem. Where you flit, no elf is sad. Twinkle, twinkle, firefly glad. I don't see why you should sing that now, said Owly. It isn't the least bit appropriate. The fireflies are not twinkling, and won't be for some time to come, if we can judge by the look of the sky. Isn't that just like Owly, said Slumber. You are always so literal, Owly, said Rhymo. Don't you know that fact hasn't half as much to do with music and poetry as fancy? Just the same, said Owly, I think our new home would have been much more appropriate. Why can't you be more agreeable, Owly? Asked the flower elf. Anything is appropriate when you're happy, and besides, Captain Featherweight left the choosing to Tono, and why shouldn't you? The music was beautiful, said Captain Featherweight. I always love to hear about the gay little fireflies. But look at the pink in the east. That means that the King of Day is coming over the hills in his chariot. To rest. To rest. Then the elves of Mount Fern lay down on their soft little beds of leaves and moss and slumbered till starlight again. The elves always begin their day in the evening instead of the morning, so that what is early for them is late for us, and what is early for us is late for them. Every evening, as soon as the stars peeped out of the sky, Captain Featherweight always gave the command, right, left, shoulder arms. This simply meant, get to work, and was the signal for every elf to be about his business. All night long the gay little elves were as busy as bees, but no matter where they were or what they were doing, they always came back to Mount Fern before sunrise and rested till starlight again. The next evening, Captain Featherweight gave his usual command, and every elf began to work. Iris Wing, the flower elf, scampered lightly down the fern ladder and went about his business in the garden. Although all the elves loved the flowers, he was the one who took most care of them, and so the other elves called him Iris Wing, the flower elf. As he wandered about from flower to flower, he whispered to each a word of good cheer. The tulips and daisies were all fast asleep and heard not a word that he said, but the roses were as wide awake as in broad daylight, and they bowed to the flower elf and said, "We're watching the Queen of Night climbing over the tall stone chimneys of Templeton Hall." While the roses were watching the moon, the flower elf went on, and was just going to speak to the foxgloves when he heard two monster voices from the giant world. And he listened, for he couldn't help listening, the voices were so loud and harsh, or so it seemed to him, although we would call them very sweet voices. It was Mary and Anna Templeton, the doctor's daughters, who were talking. "Mary," said Anna, "I've got an idea. I want to make a mattress and pillows for Emily's doll, and some of the birdhouses are just bursting with feathers. Let us fill the mattress and pillows with feathers from the bluebird's house." "Oh, that will be perfectly lovely," said Mary. "And let us have them ready for her birthday," continued Anna, "and we'll send a verse from the bluebird something like this. Dear Emily, our feathers free, without a fee, we all agree to send to thee. Won't that be fun?" laughed Mary, "but who'll get the feathers for us?" "I'll get them myself," replied Anna. "With a long stepladder, I can easily reach the bluebird's house. This evening we'll make the cases, and then tomorrow afternoon, right after school, we'll get the feathers." The flower elf, who was getting more.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.